Hi, my name's Dylan Ward. I'm here with Couch 44 today. We're going to be interviewing Cassie Hoepner today, who is doing her PhD in marine biology, also is working with conservation for her organisation Saving Nemo. Hi, Cassie, how are you?
Hi, Dylan, how are you?
Yeah, very well. So let's talk a little bit about your work and your PhD. What's your what's a day in the life? What do you get up to and what are you trying to achieve?
Yeah, so my PhD is looking at the symbiotic relationship between clownfish and sea anemones. So essentially my life is focused on Finding Nemo and that whole movie. What I'm looking at is the role that venom has had in them forming their symbiosis. So most other fish, and as we saw in Finding Dory, Dory can't enter the anemone, only Nemo and Marlin can because they're the clownfish. So we're really looking into what is so special about the clownfish. Why can they live in this toxic environment when most other fish cannot?
So when did you first realise that this was something you were passionate about and wanted to get into?
Yeah, so I grew up on the beach at Largs. We live quite close, and I used to just go every afternoon for walks down the beach and just seeing what I could find. And I remember there was always these little purple starfish that would wash up along the beach. Just occasionally, like, you'd see someone. I really loved looking for them and finding them. But one year I remember that it must have been after a big storm, or it must have been really hot, or something had changed, and there was thousands of these starfish washed up on the beach. It was crazy. It was like all of them. And I have not seen one of those purple starfish since. And I guess sort of wondering why that had happened and sort of what was behind all of these poor little starfish washing up. Sort of sparked my interest in wanting to know more about the impact that we're having on the ocean and perhaps what could be done about it. Straight out of marine biology, I got the opportunity in my honours project to work with the clownfish and the anemones, which I've been able to follow through my PhD, which has been an awesome opportunity.
Yeah, great. So had you had prior experience doing that that helped you to be able to work with them?
Not necessarily with clownfish. So during my undergrad, I worked a lot with injured sea life, like seabirds and seals. I work at a marine rescue centre. So I did have some hands-on experience with animals, but not fish specifically. So that was what I developed working with my supervisor, because we have a clownfish breeding program on campus. So the university itself has been, yeah, a great opportunity to get that experience in just the fish world as well.
Yeah, great. So you also work with Saving Nemo. How's that experience been like?
Yeah, so with the breeding program that we run on campus, we also bring a lot of schools in to see the clownfish. Obviously, being in Adelaide, we don't have clownfish out in the wild that everyone can go and just have a snorkel and have a look at. So for a lot of students, it's the first time they've seen clownfish outside of Finding Nemo and Finding Dory. So kids get very excited, and we talk a lot about conservation issues that the clownfish are facing, and it's a good way for them to bridge, yeah, conservation issues that they haven't really thought about before, like the state of the Great Barrier Reef and things like that as well.
Sure. Now, this isn't your first time on TV either. obviously, your big star of fame is your Totally Wild appearance.
Yes, I was on Totally Wild.
So how was that experience? So what were you doing in that?
Yeah, so we showed the team from Totally Wild through the clownfish breeding program, and we talked a lot about clownfish conservation and the reef and kind of the main threats the clownfish are facing as well. So the reason we run the clownfish breeding program is because a lot of clownfish are taken from the wild to be sold as pets in the aquarium trade, and this became a real big issue, particularly after Finding Nemo came out. So everyone saw these cute little fish, and they saw that they could be kept as a pet at the dentist. So everyone wanted their own little Nemo at home, but they didn't really connect with the fact that these fish came from the wild, and all those fish being taken out to become pets has an impact on those populations in the wild. And it's really not well known that it's actually quite easy to breed the clownfish themselves in captivity. So the fish that we breed, we sell on to the local pet stores, so that way they can sell a more sustainable alternative to the consumer. So you can know, you still have your pet Nemo at home, but you can know that perhaps you didn't have as much of an impact on wild populations as if you'd have bought a wild pair as well.
So coral bleaching is a massive issue at the moment and has been for many years now. Can you talk a little bit about how that's affecting the Great Barrier Reef perhaps specifically, or you know, the world?
Yeah, so I guess for like corals, for anemones, for clownfish, the number one threat to them is climate change, which causes coral bleaching. So because corals and anemones, they're all in the same family, they're impacted by this in the same way. So essentially coral bleaching is like a loss of a little algae that lives inside their tissues that provides energy to the coral or the anemone. And so when there's like increased sea surface temperature or really high solar irradiance or high sedimentation load, any of those things, anything that's not optimal, essentially really stresses out the algae. And so the coral and the anemone will just expel them, because you don't want something inside of you if it's not benefiting you in any way. So if these conditions last for a really long time, as we have been seeing in recent years, they're not able to find a new algae to bring back inside and replenish that energy. So when they're bleached, they don't die instantly, but if that period of exposure to those conditions goes for a really long time, then yeah, that can lead to death because they're not getting that energy source anymore. So essentially what we're looking at in the future is no more coral reefs. So if we don't stop, you know, pumping fossil fuels into the atmosphere, or you know, start to make really dramatic changes in how the world as a whole lives or consumes energy, it's pretty unlikely that corals will survive past 2050. So that's looking to be the tipping point where we're going to go over 1.5 degrees unless we seriously hit our Paris Agreement targets, which Australia is just not even interested in at the moment. And not just Australia needs to hit those targets. Everyone, every country in the world needs to hit those targets, or we're going to go over.
Well, thank you so much for coming on the show, Cassie. It was really nice to get to meet you and learn a little bit about your world and what you're hoping to get from your conservation and your studies. Thank you guys for watching. I've been your host, Dylan Ward, and we'll catch you on the next one.